this session on Allama Iqbal lecture, Defining Ideas and Movements in Pakistan. And in this session, we have the chairperson for this session is Dr. S.M. Naseem. And speaker for this session is Professor Syed Nawab at the Naqvi. He's in America, unfortunately, because of some problems, he could not come here, but he has sent the paper, and there will be a presentation of his paper, recorded presentation of his paper. The discussants for the session are Dr. Asad Zaman and Dr. Parvez Tahir. Introduce the chair and the speaker for this session. Both of them are my teachers, so I have high regards for them. I don't know what to say, but I'll say just a brief introduction, so let the new generation know what they are missing. Okay. Professor S.M. Naseem was his student at Qaid-e-Azam University. He taught us courses in trade in 1970s. He went after teaching at Qaid-e-Azam University, he went to SCAP, and after spending number of years at SCAP, he came back to Qaid-e-Azam University. His work on poverty and confusion is a pioneering work, and it has been cited a lot. It's basically the beginning of the research on these topics. And recently, a couple of years ago, he completed a study for PIDE as a history of PIDE series number one, and PIDE from a think tank to a university. Brief history. If you want to see the transition of PIDE from from research institution to a teaching institution, that is what you should read, that monograph which has been written by Dr. S.M. Naseem, because he knows PIDE, how the transition took place, and whether he agrees with it or not, that is another issue. Okay. Now, Professor S.M. Naseem, he is currently, again my teacher, currently he is a professor of economics at Virginia Tech University in USA. He received his master's from Yale in 1961, and then PhD from Princeton in 1966, and postdoc from Harvard in 1971. His career as a professional and academic, he's worked as visiting professor in the beginning at Middle East Technical University from 1972 to 1975, professor of economics at Qaid-e-Azam University from 75 to 1980, and then he joined PIDE and as a director. At that time it was the director, it was not vice chancellor, who was heading PIDE. Director PIDE from 79 to about 1995. After that, he was a national professor until 2004, and he was heading the Department of Economics or School of Economics at Federal Urdu University of Science and Technology in Islamabad. And he has published extensively on various issues. His articles are too numerous to cite to mention here. And he has published more than 15 books. And some of the books, which is like Economics of Development Towards Inclusive Growth, Macroeconometric Model, first macroeconometric model was developed by him at PID when he was at PID, Production Efficiency, and the Case Study of Pakistan, that was another book, the recent book, Evolution of Development Policy. All these books are for the development students are must for a read. And acknowledging his long illustrious careers in research and teaching, he was given the Stara Imtiaz in 1991, and Eco Award in 1992, Lifetime Achievement Award in 2005-06, and Lifetime Award from Kanati Institute of Russia later on. Okay, so he's looking at his illustrious careers, it is, I think, the most appropriate person for today's Allama Iqbal lecture on towards defining ideas and movements in Pakistan. So it's now I hand it over to the chair, Dr. S.M. Naseem, please.
Thank you, Rihanna. It's a pleasure indeed to be here with our group, and especially because the speaker of today's session is Professor Naqvi. Unfortunately, I understand he is not here and won't be able to make the presentation in person. a recording of his introductory speech will be played later on. Meanwhile, I'm very glad to have two very distinguished discussants with me, Professor Asad Zaman and Dr. Tahir, Parvez Tahir, who is a former chief economist and also worked for the Planning Commission for a long time. Okay, since we have enough time, I think we'll be able to open the floor for discussion as well, although I understand that the normal procedure in this year's meeting is, that the questions are submitted. I don't know if that has been done or not. Anyway, I think since we have time, we might as well, open the floor for discussion. Okay, what I'll do is say a few words in the beginning before Dr. Professor Naqvi's speech is played, and then I'll say a few words about and his paper. Okay, let me begin first of all with Professor Naqvi himself, and this is I start on a personal note by recalling my half a century long association with Professor Naqvi, during which our paths have crisscrossed a number of times, and our trajectories, both academic and professional, have often both intersected and run in parallel directions. We both got our MA degrees in economics from Karachi University in the mid-50s, and received our PhD degrees in the mid-60s. Thus, the international, he did his PhD from Princeton, I from Yale. So the intellectual milieu, as well as the political climate in which we both spent the formative years of our training as economists, were thus broadly similar, although as we outgrew the heady influence of Ivy League graduate schools and imbibed other influences on return home and facing the ground realities of developing countries, we acquired rather different perspectives. Serendipitously, our career paths also intersected frequently, but we are often met in revolving doors when one was entering while the other was exiting from a chosen institution. Dr. Naqvi joined PIDE in 1961 when I was leaving it for my studies at Yale. Again in 1974, when I was on my leave of absence from QA, you, Professor Naqvi, assumed office as professor and chairman of economics department. In the previous 6 years, I had unsuccessfully tried to induce Professor Naqvi to join KU's then fledgling economics department, especially after Professor Anisa Rahman as departure for Dhaka in 1970, which was a great setback to the department that had started making some waves. We worked as a team and as contemporaneous colleagues at Qaed-e-Azam University from 1974 to 1978, along with some other then young colleagues, such as Professor Arsalan, who had turbocharged our teaching capabilities and enhanced its reputation. The coming of PIDE to the campus in 1972, which I was asked to oversee, also enhanced the department's viability. However, this was a mixed blessing, as the Institute's Board of Governors refused to agree on any cooperative arrangement between the two institutions and insisted on its autonomy from the university, as PIDE was able to offer its staff much better emoluments. I guess that continues to be the case. The most unfortunate consequence of which, at least for the Qaid-e Azam University, though not for the profession, was that Professor Naqvi left Qaid-e Azam University to join PIDE as its director and as ex-officio president of PSDE, which he founded as a forum for development economists, not only of Pakistan, but of the whole world, especially of South Asian region. Its annual meetings attracted economists from far and wide and provided great stimulus to developing economic research. This will rightfully be remembered as the lasting legacy of Professor Naqvi, both to Pakistan and the economics profession. I'm grateful to Professor Naqvi that he specifically mentions in his speech the twin institutions, PIDE and QAU, in which QAU Economics Department, in which both of us spent the bulk of our working lives. I congratulate him on his highly successful career and for writing such a well-researched paper on which he spent a whole year of his retired life to crown the academic his academic achievement. Without further ado, let us hear Professor Naqvi, Naqvi's Allama Iqbal lecture, and give him a big hand before he starts.
Professor Asad Nasim, Chairman. Professor Asad Zaman, President, PhD, and Dr. Fazal Hussain, the Secretary of the PSD, and distinguished participants. Assalamu alaikum. I am grateful to Professor Asad Zaman and Dr. Fazal Hussain for inviting me to deliver the Allama Iqbal lecture, which honors the memory of the great poet and philosopher, like of whom will not be born again. He was a far-sighted political leader, an idea giver who could see through the mist of time. He extended wholehearted support to Qaid-e Azam Muhammad Ali Jinnah when many others were filled with anxiety and doubt about the prospects of an independent Muslim nation, Pakistan. He kindled the candle of hope in the hearts of Muslims everywhere, reminded them of their past glory, and admonished them to work hard to relive it in the present. He ends his beautiful poem Masjid-e-Qartaba on the soul-stirring message, Naqsh-e sab na tamam, khoon-e-jigar ke baghair, nagma hai sauda-e kham, khoon-e-jigar ke baghair. That is, no picture is complete without painting it with intense hard work. I hope that my 50-page essay, which has taken me 1 year to write and which I have subjected to countless revisions, relives that spirit. I am grateful to Dr. Fazal Hussain for finally finding the optimal chairman in the person of my old friend and colleague, Professor Syed Muhammad Naseem. He without doubt has played a pioneering role in the promotion of economic science in Qaid-e Azam University and the Pakistan Institute of Development Economics. My thanks to also Dr. Rehana Siddiqui, a former student of mine, who is one of the best macroeconomists in Pakistan, for saying kind words of introduction about me. My list of complimentary adjectives will, however, not be complete if I did not mention my niece, Hassan Fatma, who has recorded my lecture here in the US, and my former colleague, Naveed Arshad for coordinating it in Pakistan. Both have made it possible that you hear my message in Pakistan, crossing several time zones and seven seas. Thank you all. I now turn to relating my story of the triumphs and tribulations of the givers of economic ideas, which, like all good stories, has an engaging beginning and an exciting end that has a moral and an uplifting message. I begin in a rather self-congratulatory and triumphal mood with the assertion that economists are not the practitioners of dismal science who, sitting in the luxury of ivory towers, spin models far removed from reality. That they make models is true, but they are based on their understanding of the real world. All great economists, beginning with Adam Smith, who with common consent is both the Adam and the Smith of modern economics, wrote his masterwork, The Wealth of Nations, in 1979 to comprehend the scope and consequences of the Industrial Revolution in England that occurred in the same year and which for the first time showed that long-lasting inclusive growth of per capita income was possible and capable of transforming the wretched lives of the common men and not just of the rich and the powerful. A few years before that, in 1979, he wrote his other classic, The Theory of Moral Sentiments, to emphasize the moral values that must underlie economic undertakings to humanize them and make them relevant to the people. It is interesting to remember that, as Jesse Norman in his authentic biography of Adam Smith has shown, that he to the end of his life emphasized that both of these works should be read together, as if to disabuse the impression of the existence of two Adam Smiths, one of the Wealth of Nations, emphasizing selfishness and greed, and the other of the Theory of Moral Sentiments, advocating altruism and human goodness. He was a moral philosopher whose economic thinking reflected his philosophy of life, that well-functioning markets must be based on universally held moral values. Malthus, who was basically an accomplished mathematician, warned labor of mindless procreation, which would forever keep wages at the subsistence level. Next in the line of the great writers comes Karl Marx, who studied the post-industrial revolution world in England and deplored the pitiable conditions of labor, as opposed to those of the capitalists in the factories, which created surplus values, which was not actually paid out to labor, but pocketed by the latter for their use. He, like no one else, pointed out the fundamental flaws of predatory capitalism to save the world from its evil consequences, such as the infinite accumulation of wealth in the hands of a few grabbers, which could lead to socialist life and revolutions. Then in 1980, Alfred Marshall, a mathematician, was drawn to economics to do something for the welfare of humankind. Nearer to our times, John Maynard Keynes tried to understand the post-Great Depression world, in which widespread involuntary unemployment was the urgent problem to be tackled by economists and policymakers. More than scientific rigor, he wished to unlock the secrets of the working of an economy suffering from system-wide pathologies of underemployment and unemployment. His primary concern was to harness the economic forces for the good of the society. Fast forward to modern times. Psychological studies, mostly those which Nobel laureates Daniel Kahneman and Richard Thaler pioneered and perfected, have focused on gaining a better understanding of how humans and not the homo economicus of neoclassical economics actually behave as they do in the real world rather than in the neoclassical models. They powerfully rebelled against the widely, indeed universally held belief among economists that people are generally rational and that their thinking is normally sound, and that people depart from rationality only in states of anger, fear, hatred, affection. They have rejected both these perceptions about human behavior. Instead, they showed that normal people with limited cognitive abilities and willpower care not only for efficiency but also for fair play and social justice. Normally, their decisions suffer from systematic errors, and that these errors are traceable to the machinery of cognition rather than to the corruption of thought by emotions. Their explanations about the marvel as well as the flaws of intuitive thought. The latest idea givers are Paul Romer and William Nordhaus. Both got the Nobel Prize this year. The former has helped us to understand the complexities of growth, to unravel its mystery. How growth arises endogenously from the working of the economic system itself, and help us to open the black box of technological change. Miss Nobel laureate Robert Solow showed his determined exogenously, while Nordhaus throws the sunlight on the complex relationship between climate change and economic growth. The aim of both is to help rewrite economics so that it is more helpful to humanity. Each one of these flag bearers of great ideas took them at full flood and rode them to success. The ideas of these great economists, thanks to the immensity of their influence, are referred to as revolutions. The Keynesian revolution, the behavioral economics revolution, and the latest being the growth revolution. The word revolution here does not signify a violent uprooting of the social fabric. It rather indicates a paradigmatic change in the realm of ideas, a new way of doing science. No guns are fired, no lives lost, and most people go about their daily chores normally. And yet, they change human societies dramatically. I now turn to some of the issues that have exercised economists in the present day and which are also policy relevant. First is the perennial debate about the relationship between the market and the government. This is important because it is an essential element of the Washington consensus that the government be minimized, which advice is then exported to developing countries, especially as they are normally the ones who have to knock the IMF's door. No matter what is the subject of discussion, education, poverty, income inequality, climate change, whatever exercises our thoughts normally, with astounding regularity, the debate soon turns to whether the free markets are better or worse than the government. Though oftentimes the debate is done in a meaningless way, putting the issue in an either-or way is meaningless because markets cannot exist without the government, which makes the laws. And institutions within which the markets work, within the markets must work. Government does not intrude the market, it makes them. Civilization is defined by rules. Rules create markets, and it is the government that makes the rules. Furthermore, this debate, besides being futile, also diverts attention from more important questions about who makes these rules, which define the markets, who the government is for, and for whom the bell tolls, are the real issues which only figure in this debate only tangentially and as an afterthought. The fact is that these rules mirror a society's evolving norms and values and reflect the institutions or persons who have the most power to make or influence them. For instance, in the background of the neoliberalist call for liberalization and privatization are the interests of the rich and powerful who gain the most from the transfer of public wealth to private hands, which in most cases take the form of asset stripping, loot and plunder. Indeed, as Carl Polanyi, the great historical economist, has pointed out, that those who ask for less government are indeed asking for a different government, one that is more inclined to serve the interests of the powerful, rather than be preoccupied by the size of the government. A more important concern, therefore, is to who gains and who loses each time the government is organized and reorganized. I now turn to the second fundamental issue that I discuss at length in my essay, which is about capitalism. The popular demand, including in Pakistan, is to abolish it. It is not surprising, as this is also the demand in the Western countries. The reason is that if steps are not taken to humanize capitalism, it is by its nature divisive in that it leads to inequality of income and wealth and sows the seeds of social discord. And yet I argue that capitalism be not thrown away in a huff of ill-informed reformism. Looking at its history, capitalism has come in various shapes and colors. Indeed, one cannot but be struck by its high transmutability over time and across systems. As an engine of innovation and growth, as a source of crisis and exploitation and alienation, no less than as a subject of scholarly research and social critique. The multidimensionality of capitalism and its malleability implies that it be reformed and pressed in the service of humankind as the welfare states of which Denmark, where people are not only prosperous and also happy, is the prime example, have done to meet the competing demands of growth and humanness and equity. And yet the fact is that for all its munificence as unrivaled creator of wealth and the guarantor of personal freedom, capitalism seems to have lost its way as the modern corporations, which embodies the capitalist creed, has fallen prey to crony capitalism, which seems to have thrived on the enormous profitability of lobbying. It has become an externalizing machine, adept at pushing costs to others, suppressing wages, and erecting barriers to new entry. It has led to escalating inequities and a coarsening of moral values. What we are witnessing is the simultaneous rise of the non-working rich and the working poor, and the declining bargaining power of labor vis-a-vis the capitalists. The fact is that capitalism is losing its legitimacy as an engine of wealth creation and personal freedom. And the cumulative result of these trends is that the economic system is becoming more and more pro-capital and anti-labor, raising the Marxian specter of infinite accumulation of power and wealth in the hands of the capitalists and the gradual euthanasia of labor. The challenge before us is therefore no less than rewriting or writing a new social contract which is more humane, just and efficient, so that people do not lose faith in the government and the economic system. We need better frameworks of thought, better explanations, and better shared identities through which we can come to terms with the basic problem that we face, the remedy is for the vast majority to regain influence over how a market is organized. This will require a new countervailing power to allay the concern of the majority who have not shared the economy's gains. Of the many proposals I make, let me reiterate two. One is the need to catch up growth with a view to ending poverty, deprivation and ill-being of the people. And the other is to make a steady progress towards the ideal of a welfare state in the developing countries, including Pakistan. As to catch up growth, defined as graduating from the status of a country with a per capita income of say $500 in purchasing power parity terms to say $2,700, which is the lower end of the developed country status, is not achieved quickly and easily. It takes much time and energy, above all, persistence, to get an idea of the time it takes. Catch-up growth means growing at a rate at least 7% per annum for 25 years at a stretch. This is high bar to cross, which so far only 13 countries of the 130 developing countries have achieved, though more countries like India and some in Africa are aiming to achieve it. The star performer among the elites is of course China, which has doubled per capita income in 7 years, growing at the rate of 10% per annum. When this happens, poverty reduction is dramatic. In China, over 700 people have been pulled up about $2 a day. In addition, we have the Asian Tigers, which doubled per capita incomes in 12 years, growing at the rate of 6% per annum. This is miraculous growth, though it is repeatable and not beyond human effort, which means that short-term spurts of growth are not the way to achieve it. Once begun, the journey along the high growth trajectory must continue without break to bear fruit. Our desire to become prosperous and happy overnight is great, but if wishes were horses, then as Shakespeare put it, beggars would ride it. This is important advice that policymakers must keep in view. The next issue is as to which policies can make it possible for a developing country to develop on a sustained basis. The traditional advice is to save and invest in physical and human capital as much as 25% to 30% of the GDP per annum. We now know that just physical and human capital formation, though essential, are not enough. In addition, as Paul Romer, this year's Nobel laureate, has shown, knowledge which has the property of endogenous growth due to increasing returns to scale has to be created and widely shared. In addition, leaving it to the market will not make it possible. State intervention is essential, as it involves what is referred to as an externality. This another factor which sustains growth and which I discuss at length is the Nobel laureate North, that growth on a sustained basis requires the creation and strengthening of democratic, inclusive economic and political institutions that are sufficiently centralized and pluralistic. Historically, the creation and sustenance of such institutions takes a lot of blood spilling and constant struggle. This is partly because economic growth is essentially a transformative and destabilizing process and is carried forward with creative destruction and a lot of violence, as the great economist Joseph Schumpeter pointed out. I now come to the second point I have made in this essay. It is that without social justice, societies cannot stay long on the high road of growth and development. in this context, the biggest worry that must exercise the policymakers is the universal phenomenon of rising inequalities of income and wealth, which is measured by the share of 1% in national income and wealth. The World Inequality Report for this year is the latest and the most authentic source which I have cited in my essay. Pakistan is not included in this report, but it shows that in India, the inequality of income has risen rapidly since independence to 55% of income and wealth going to the top rich, which is the highest in the world with the exception of the Middle East. The report also shows that in China, the inequalities are the lowest in developing countries and are comparable with those in advanced countries. It points out that one of the leading factors leading to rising inequalities of income and wealth is the transfer of public wealth to private hands through privatization and deregulation. This has greatly reduced the ability of the governments to take measures to reduce inequalities. The other factors working in the same direction are the general reduction in progressive taxation, income and wealth taxation, and the abolition of inheritance taxes. Pakistan has generally followed the same path, and we must be careful in not adopting a business as usual attitude toward this problem. This situation requires collective action to avoid social, political, and economic catastrophes. I have argued most emphatically that we move gradually and steadily towards the welfare state ideal, which is the only way to combine productive efficiency with social justice, as the experience of the Scandinavian countries shows. It really enables an individual to realize his full potential as he is relieved from the worries of access to health, education, and unemployment. Lest this proposal be dismissed as a pipe dream, I have examined it at some length in my essays, the problems the developing countries will have to face to move towards this ideal. In particular, there is need to reform the system of taxation and wealth by making it more progressive to finance rising social expenditure. In this context, historical evidence shows that the taxation of inheritance is the most effective measure, which has no effect on work effort. In particular, the current practices of increasing taxes on consumer spending and higher taxation of labor income, which are regressive, must be reversed. There are too many holy cows in Pakistan, like agriculture, which roam around untaxed, and which can be brought in the tax net if the rich show some spine and determination to work for the welfare of the society. We have seen the retreat from the welfare state in our country before our own eyes. Public education has become expensive, and government finance hospitals have been replaced by so-called expensive and inefficient English schools and private hospitals. At this philosophical level, one can think of the process of social change I advocate in this essay as a peaceful passage from an ill-ordered society to what the great philosopher John Rawls refers to as a well-ordered society, which is governed by rules of behavior that are fair and just, because these have been arrived at behind the veil of ignorance, so that one does not know what his or her place would be in such a society. Specifically, these rules are described as the justice and fairness principle and the difference principle. These principles imply that no one finds a gainful place in the society by virtue of the circumstances of his birth or early nurture, and that the needs of the least privileged are given top priority. If there was ever a time to make a fresh start, to think logically and practically, to illumine the withered lives of the voiceless majority. It is here and now. This needs to be done by applying not only efficiency, but moral correctives, so that our fragile socio-economic system does not get capsized before the unrelenting fury of unabated greed that modern capitalism represents. As we tread the high road to economic and social development, we should make sure that it throws the sunlight on the homes enveloped in the darkness of poverty. Thank you. وما علينا إلا البلاغ.
Thank you very much, Professor Naqvi. Now, before I request the two discussants to comment on Professor Naqvi's paper, I'd like to say a few words. I'm sure you all have enjoyed listening to his stimulating talk. But you know, his paper, which the detailed paper, which has probably been circulated, on defining ideas and movements in economics, is much more exhaustive, and is intended to enlighten us on the major currents in the economic literature, from Adam Smith to Thomas Piketty, to choose somewhat arbitrarily the two most recognizable milestones covering the long and breathtaking journey of his discourse, which have influenced the economics profession of our generation. It is indeed a very thorough review of the major theoretical developments in economics over the last two centuries or more, with profound impact on public policy and human welfare. Professor Naqvi explores these ideas in the quest of finding how eminent economists of past two centuries or more have contributed in defining the ideas and directions which have helped enable the building of progressively more efficient, equitable, and humane societies over time. In my view, the elephant in the room, a rather overused metaphor these days, in Professor Naqvi's paper is capitalism, a word which received world renown through Marx's seminal work. It finds no mention in Adam Smith's work in collaboration with his almost two centuries ago. That work, that is Marx's work, continues to powerfully influence the minds and hearts of billions across the globe since then, was probably the closest to identifying the essence of this behemoth as a whole, while the other proverbial blind men were able to identify only one or two of its features, such as property rights, representative government, free markets, and consumerist culture. For Marx, it was its irrepressible proclivity to rampage in its environs, and the impossibility of chaining it when it ran amok was its defining characteristic. Unfortunately, his work receives disproportionately little attention in most mainstream surveys of current economic literature, often reducing it almost to a footnote. Professor Naqvi's paper does, however, give Marx a prominent place in the discourse, even though it is overshadowed in the broad canvas he has chosen to enlighten the reader on more recent developments in the discipline, largely by focusing on the esoteric works of recent Nobel laureates rather than on a particular author or theoretical school. Although Professor Naqvi acknowledges the potential predatory nature of capitalism, he remains clearly enamored of it and warns us not to overthrow it in a huff, like the baby with the bathwater. He seems inclined to believe that the proverbial elephant of capitalism can be easily tamed and harnessed to yield productive benefits for all and not only the owners of capital, real or financial, and that no other animal can render the human service if chained, that is, regulated and mounted by an accompanied mahout, that is, the economic managers. Unfortunately, as Professor Naqvi himself would agree, this does not seem to be borne out by history. Capitalism has a long and unsavory history of breaking its chains, the regulations imposed by the state, and causing havoc as a predator. It has a sordid history of creating booms and busts in the economy, the burdens of which fall mainly on the poor, while the benefits are captured mainly by the rich. For Marx, labor and capital were locked in a prey and predator relationship for their survival, growth, and well-being, and this struggle is likely to continue until the system is overthrown and replaced by one which does away with capitalism's inherent contradictions. Professor Naqvi believes that there is really no practical alternative to capitalism, and that one has to look for the ways in which it can be reformed to remedy its defects, especially the endemic problem of inequality and poverty, which is its inevitable concomitant. This is where Professor Naqvi highlights Piketty's monumental work on capital in the 21st century, which has been making waves since its publication in 2014, although its existence has been blissfully ignored in Pakistan. The world has become increasingly sensitive to the issues of income and wealth inequality since Piketty's book appeared. Such bizarre facts as the richest 1% now control more than half the globe's total wealth, and a dozen billionaires own more than what half the world's population does, continues to hit the headlines, bringing the grotesque inequities of global capitalism. Professor Naqvi uses the concept of catch-up growth to illustrate how late industrializers like South Korea have used it to catapult themselves into the league of middle-income and developed countries through shrewd industrial policy choices, rather than following the neoliberal policies templated by IMF and the World Bank, notoriously known as the Washington Consensus. At the same time, Professor Naqvi cautions them to avoid the emergence of income inequality and poverty as a collateral damage of rapid industrialization inherent in catch-up growth. The overarching message of Professor Naqvi's paper is to debunk the neoliberal belief that markets always work for the best of everyone, and that the state should intervene in the economy only when it must, sometimes to save the system from itself, as happened during the 2007-08 financial crisis, when a number of banks and large corporations, such as General Motors and large private banks, had to be taken over by the government instead of being allowed to go bankrupt, except in the case of Lehman Brothers, because they were deemed too big to fail. In terms of the global ramifications and lasting effects of the 2008 financial crisis, was much more severe than that of the Great Depression of the 1930s. It has raised severe alarms again about the stability of the system and the specter of another serious global economic crisis soon, surpassing that of 2008. During the past decade, although capitalism's stability has been salvaged to some extent by adopting Keynesian tools of fiscal stimulus and monetary easing, in most affected countries, fears abound that deeply fragmented world economy may not unravel again soon. With increasing income inequalities, the world is increasingly moving towards nationalism and away from globalism, as evident by Brexit and the aggressive posture of the US since the last presidential elections. In the US, the leading standard bearer of capitalism. The rise of populism, both right and left, has polarized societies across the globe and is making the system more and more unworkable and prone to the likelihood of global and regional conflicts. The billion, or perhaps the trillion-dollar question, still remains that, given its many contradictions and imperfections, what, if any, system can replace capitalism? The key condition being that it would be arrived at through consensus in a pluralistic world characterized by diversity of faiths, beliefs, and aspirations in a highly complex and interdependent world economy. Professor Naqvi himself seems to favor the Scandinavian model of welfare state, although the countries which are following it also seem to be in deep trouble. There has also been talk of the Medina model, on which I'm sure Dr. Zaman will have a lot to say. As an alternative to the present day capitalism. There are others who think the Soviet model can still be revived if it can incorporate some features of capitalism, such as market agency, signals and transparency, and accountability. Clearly, a hybrid model suited to the needs of each society and value system is called for. Continued research and debate along the lines of Professor Naqvi's paper alone will crystallize the answer. I'll now request Professor Asad Zaman to give his comments as the first discussant.
Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Many topics have been addressed, and discussion can go on forever. It was a very broad paper covering the whole history of economic thought. I will focus on very, very, very sharp and point, which I think is most relevant. Basically, there is a vast range of ideas out there. Which is right, which is wrong, how do we know? Wo usne kaha hai ke Faiz Ahmed Faiz ne ke gadi hain hazar salibe mere dariche pe har ek apne masiha ke khoon ka rang liye. To messages jo aa rahe hain wo bahut sare hain, thousands of powerful messages, and each with a very passionate pleader, one who is ready to give his blood for his message. So how can we tell the truth? Now, this is very difficult. This is not an easy job. This is what we have been sent to this planet for. This is a planet, is a test to see who can find his path to the truth. So this is the nature of the test, to be able to distinguish between the right and the wrong. And now, if you think of economic theory as a warfare, theory is not about describing the world. As Joan Robinson said, you learn economics not because you want to understand how the world works, but to avoid being deceived by economists. So this is the main thing, that economics is warfare. Every economic policy creates losers and it creates winners. So it is in the interest of some people to push that policy, and nobody wants to reveal that this policy is just in our interest. So for example, when America invaded Iraq to capture the oil, nobody ever said that we are doing this because we want to gain control of oil. They said, no, there are weapons of mass destruction, there is an evil dictator, the public is oppressed, and Allah and Bala. So the thing is that deception is very, very common. And East Asian crisis occurred, the East Asian miracle. There's a World Bank report called the East Asian miracle. It lists about 8 to 10 strategies, non-market strategies, which the East Asian countries followed in order to achieve their miracle. After that, the WTO was created, the World Trade, and it banned all of those 8 strategies that are listed in their book as being the secrets of Asian success, and we have signed this. We have no option. I mean, you can't opt out of the World Trade System. So they don't want to create any other winners. So the today, the poorest countries of the world pay billions of dollars in tribute to the richest countries. And it's by the confessions of the economic hitman. How is it done? We are given loans. We are told that this is good for you. Take this loan. The econometric model supports it. And our poor students also write papers and theses showing that these things are so good for us to take a loan and acquire productivity. So the point is that economic theory is mass deception. It's a weapon of mass deception. And the battle is on, and the battle is for the hearts and minds of our students. It is your generation. We've already played the game. But the battle is on for your hearts and minds. And so and the consequences are paid for in your lives. So it's very important to understand the games that are going on. What is the weapon that is the strongest and most powerful? Ibn Khaldun said it a long time ago. The rise and fall of nations depends on the cohesion of the community. If we are a group, and also the Quran says the same thing, that if you are united, nobody can come overcome you. And if you are separated with each other, then no one can help you. So today, warfare is going on, and it is dividing us, not just the Pakistan, but the Ummah, along every fault line imaginable. So we are fighting the Sunnis versus the Shias, the Barelvis versus the Deobandis, the Ahlehadees, the secular versus the religious, the wealthy versus the rich, the wealthy versus the poor, the capitalist versus the labor. Every single fault line that exists in the society, it is somebody is pouring oil on it and striking a match and making sure that. So what is the weapon that can overcome it? It is love for each other. Rahmatul lil alameen showed us the formula. When he came to Medina, he created mawakhat. He created brotherhood between the Ansar and the Muhajireen. And the Quran mentions that, remember when you were enemies and Allah Ta'ala united your hearts in love. And if you are united, and this is a treasure which not all the wealth in the world can buy. So the game is on, the battle is deadly, we will pay with our lives. And what is the weapon in the hand of many? It's the individualism, it's the pursuit of pleasure. Look, you worry only about yourself. You drink your Coca-Cola and enjoy your life. Don't worry if all your friends and all your people are miserable. You can make a good life for yourself. This is the message which is being given to you on your social media, in the movies, in the newspapers, that only be concerned with your own self. Don't worry about anything else. And that is exactly the strongest weapon against the unity that is required. The opposite message is, I don't care anything for myself. I don't seek anything for myself. I want to use my life to serve the creation of Allah out of the love of Allah. And if you make that intention, I don't seek anything for myself, Allah Ta'ala will give you everything that you need. And that is the only weapon that we have. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Zaman. I wish you had commented at least on some points of Professor Naqvi, rather than indulging in these generalizations. Anyway, that's your prerogative.
Yes.
Dr. Parvez Tahir is the second discussant.
Professor Naseem, I think it is for the first time Allama Iqbal lecture is about ideas. I hope the next lecture will be about the ideas of Allama Iqbal himself. Let's not forget that his first book was Ilmul Iqtisad. I think it was Keynes who said that never underestimate the power of ideas. practical men and politicians and those in the line of authority are all slaves of some defunct economist. Now, Professor Naqvi has admirably covered, in fact, telescoped about two centuries of economic thought and has, without saying it, talked about the defunct economists. When he says, I mean, he admits that there is no greater power than capital to create wealth. But then he warns about the dangers that capital accumulation, a la capitalism, can bring about. He talks about the dangers, but as most of us, he has no recipe of how to deal with these dangers. He stopped short of talking about alternatives. Marx, like everybody else, he understands as the best critique of capitalism. But even Marx doesn't give a workable alternative to capitalism. So he ends up saying that we should have a social contract, that those involved in the polity and economy of a country should agree on something, and this constant battle between labor and capital should be disciplined in some humane way. This is the message of his lecture. You know, he has always written about social justice, and all his articles, lectures end up with something about social justice. Now, social justice, the problem with social justice is that it doesn't happen. You have to make it happen. And if you look around in our own society, I think social justice is well written into the Constitution of the Islamic Republic, but all its elements are officially disregarded. That Professor Naqvi did not bring in the subject that is now current, future of work. You see, what kind of work is going to be there? With all this robotics, artificial intelligence, and so on, shall we need workers one day? What do you do in that situation? That is another element which has been, which should have been taken care of. But then, you know, he's a classical economist, Professor Naqvi. Welfare state, I mean, even Marshall has welfare aspects to him, although reading into Marshall, you can sort of conclude any way you like. All he was talking about was how to make supply and demand somehow work. But the essential thing is that the state cannot abdicate its responsibility. Now, who represents the state becomes a crucial question. And that requires democracy in which all classes participate, and not just those rank seekers who use the system to their benefit. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Professor. The only thing is that Professor Naqvi is not here to respond to anything you have on about his paper. And so you can give some general comments, and perhaps the panel can try to give answers. also we can have discussion among ourselves. So it's not a question and answer session so much as a comment session, which is usually discouraged in such meetings. But I think we'll make an exception to this rule and invite comments. But since we have only 15 minutes, we probably can handle 5 or 6 people at a time. Would you please, yes, sir. Could you identify yourself before you?
एक एकड़ जमीन वाले को एक रुपया टैक्स देना चाहिए, 100 एकड़ वाले को 100 रुपया. सेकंड पॉइंट, इकबाल वाज इम्प्रेस फ्रॉम जापान्स टेक्नोलॉजिकल एडवांसमेंट, और वो नॉलेज बेस्ड इकोनॉमी की बात करते हैं कि अगर अक्वाम की सफ में तरक्की करनी है तो आपने टेक्नोलॉजिकल बेस्ड एडवांसमेंट में अपना शेयर डालना होगा. जैसे कल बात हो रही थी कि यूनिवर्सिटीज़ आर द इंजन ऑफ ग्रोथ फॉर एडवांसमेंट एंड इनोवेशन, बट कल ये बात हो रही थी कि हमारी यूनिवर्सिटीज़ में हमारी रिसर्च को पॉलिसी मेकर वो वेटेज नहीं दे रहे. तो इकबाल ने साइंटिफिक इनोवेशन पे जोर दिया है और कहा है कि अपने एक शेर में, जो आलम इजाद में है साहिब इजाद, जो आलम इजाद में है साहिब इजाद, हर दौर में करता है तवाफ उसका ज़माना. यानी आज भी बड़े बड़े जितने साइंटिस्ट गुजरे हैं, सारी दुनिया उनका तवाफ कर रही है और कयामत तक करती रहेगी. जो पॉइंट डॉक्टर साहब ने मेंशन किया, इकबाल एक और शेर में कहते हैं, मैं डॉक्टर असद जमान की बात को सेकेंड करूँगा, के किनात न कर आलम रंग बू पे, चमन और भी आशियाँ और भी हैं, इसी रोज़ शब में उलझ कर न रह जा कि तेरे जमा और मका और भी हैं. लास्ट में मैं सिर्फ दो शेर, इकबाल की एक गज़ल है, इबलीस का अपने सियासी कारिंदों को वसीहत, लाकर बरहमनों को सियासत के पेच में, जानारियों को देर कोहन से निकाल दो, वो फाका कश जो मौत से डरता नहीं ज़रा, ये सहाबा के बारे में है, वो फाका कश जो मौत से डरता नहीं ज़रा, रूहे मोहम्मद उनके बदन से निकाल दो, फ़िक्रे अरब को दे के फरंगी तखयलात, फ़िक्रे अरब को दे के फरंगी तखयलात, इस्लाम को हिजाज व यमन से निकाल दो, अफगानियों के गैरत दीन का है ये इलाज, मुल्ला को उनके कोह दमन से निकाल दो, अहले हरम से इनकी रिवायात छीन लो, आहू को मरगुजार खतन से निकाल दो, इकबाल के नफस से है लाले की आग तेज़, ऐसे गज़ल सरा को चमन से निकाल दो.
Dr. Ali, just request people to confine their comments to the contents of Professor Naqvi's paper and speech. Thank you so much.
Professor Naseem, you said that there was an elephant in the room, and that elephant is capitalism. I think there's another elephant in the room, and that is the state. Because I think what I found missing in the paper was that there is this concept of an ideal state which will deliver the welfare that Professor Naqvi is talking about. But I think capitalism itself has changed or altered the nature of the state. And working with the state, you realize that very critically. So I think the notion of the state as the deliverer of welfare and public good and public services should also be questioned as to whether it has remained the way we foresee and we want it to be, or rather it has changed its complexion. Thank you.
My name is Shabib Haider Syed. I am from Foreman Christian College, Lahore. I appreciate the point of view of Naqvi Sahab. There is battle of ideas that should be, that's going on, and it will continue rather than battle of, as Dr. Asad Zaman pointed out, of Sunnis and Shias. And but the problem is, if we take it, deception, as Dr. Asad Zaman commented, wo bakaul ghalib ke main bhi thodi shayari suna dun ke alam tamam halka e dame khayal hai. To agar alam tamam halka e dame khayal hai to bazate khud ye bhi to deception hai ke hum apne students ko yahi batate rahe ke janab aap dil se soche dimag ko side pe kar de kyunki dil se mohabbat paida hogi nafrat nahi hogi. But the reality of even if Islamic history is there, Spain mein aap koi halwa baantne to nahi gaye the hum. We have murdered the history, and if we are not teaching them well about the history of economic thought and history of ideas, then we are deceiving them. And this by itself is a great deception of ideas, that we involve them in the things which for they are not responsible. My question from you on this Naqvi Sahab paper, how the conflict in Pakistan society, how the conflict Pakistan society can be solved, not at the individual level, at the state level, as Dr. Alia has asked.
Mera naam Saddam hai aur mera taluk Sialkot se hai. Main badi jasarat ke saath Dr. Pervez saab se ek sawal puchna chah raha hu. Basically aapne kaha ki ji jamhooriyat hamare in masail ka shayad hal hai, lekin chunki ye lecture Iqbal saab ke ideas pe aur se रिलेट कर रहा था, तो इकबाल साहब ने तो कहा था कि जमहूरियत वो तर्ज़ हुकूमत है जिसमें इंसानों को गिना जाता है, तोला नहीं जाता. तो उनका तो ये पॉइंट ऑफ व्यू कभी भी नहीं हुआ कि आप जमहूरियत की तरफ चले जाएं या इवन के. सो इस पे अगर आप थोड़ा सा डॉक्टर परवेज साहब अगर थोड़ी सी रोशनी डालें तो. थैंक यू
भाई. इकबाल ने कहा कि इस सफ़े पर कुछ और कहा हुआ है, तो इस बहस में पढ़ेंगे तो बहुत दूर चले जाएँगे. I was only referring to Professor Naqvi's concept of social contract and how such social contract can be put in place. For that you need a constitution, you need democracy, and I said you need a representative democracy jisme bandon ko tola bhi ja sakta hai, sirf gina nahi ja sakta.
Answer to the question about is this is also a battle of ideas. I am appealing that we should try to unite, and he is saying that it has never been done. So what is the answer? Well, Islam is process oriented. It says that you may never achieve the goal. The perfection that you seek will not exist. All we can do is to try for it. So that is the answer, I think. That's all.
Ji, my name is Mangla. In the last 20 years, from 1997 to 2017, capitalism has produced a large amount of inequality among countries, among nations. Perhaps the biggest inequality has happened in the United States. Similar situations are found in emerging countries like Pakistan. I'm not here to defend capitalism. I realize the theme of all today's talk and Professor Naqvi's talk. If we look back at the 200, 300 history of economic thought, economic development process, among all the three, four systems which we have, which world has experienced, perhaps the best empirical evidence in terms of functioning the system has been capitalism. We have seen the Soviet Union model. We have seen the Chinese communist model. Islamic viewpoint has emerged in the last, I mean, the concept has been there for 1400 plus years, as we learn from the Holy Quran. But the focus of Islamic economics has started in the last 50 years since 1970s. So let's try to look at some of the extreme inequalities created by capitalism and try to increase the minimum wage required for the labor, which is happening even in North American and Western economies. And Islam has provided a mechanism clearly in terms of charitable donations, the concept of zakat, where we can remove these extreme volatilities and produce the ideal goals of Islamic society. After all, it took 500 years, perhaps the first bank, commercial bank, started in 1495 in Spain or Italy, I don't remember the exact. But with 500 years of banking experience, we have come a long way in terms of providing the financial services. And still we get bumps every 20 years with a little financial crisis. Islamic mode of financing, what we call Islamic banking and finance, is one area where some of these inequalities and some of these issues of credit can be sort of progressed. So let's not blame all the time capitalism, okay? It has its merit. It has worked very well, producing erratic inequalities, but that's one of the best available model in the empirical history of economic history of the world. Thank you. And there's no alternative. We would love to have an Islamic economic model. Take the example, for 40 years, Islamic banking has not moved beyond markup financing. Okay? There's less than 1% of assets of Islamic banks devoted to the long-term instruments of Musharakah, Mudarabajh. Thank you.
No time, and of course we miss Professor Naqvi. Had he been here, the discussion would have been much more fruitful than it has been.
Hello.
Okay, thank you very much once again. I thank the organizers.
Thank you, ladies and gentlemen, for this. That was all about this session. I would request Dr. Asad Zaman to please present some token of love to our chairperson, Mr. S.M. Naseem. As the speaker, Syed Nawab Haider Naqvi, is not here, I would request Dr. Rehana to please accept the souvenir on his behalf. Thank you so much.